I'm Rolf Kramer. A little bit of background. I worked for a seed company in the Netherlands selling seeds to Russian collective farms from 93 to 95, so that was quite a wild time. After that, I did an MBA and ended up with Novartis, which is now Syngenta, selling crop protection chemicals to also wild countries like Turkmenistan and Kazakhstan. So it was very important to know the value chain and understand that not only your little input is making the revenues of the farmers, but that you have to think about the whole value chain. So after Novartis, I worked for LMC, which is an economic consulting company analyzing the value chains for agricultural commodities. So that gave me a good insight on what is going on worldwide. In 2014, I started a project as a consultant with British Sugar and Resotec, the company I work for now, in order to use crop modeling in order to predict the growth of sugar beet and also analyze why sugar beets grow in order to anticipate for different political changes in the EU. So out of that project, I became the head of agriculture for Resotec, and I will show you what I'm doing here now. So I'll tell you a little bit about Resotec. The challenge is what we face, data in isolation and data in context. We have talked about that. The data just is not what we need, but more processing. A platform that we use in order to analyze and process this data, and then how we see our future. So a little bit history of Resotec. It started as a company in 2012, a spin out from UCL, using algorithms in order to map carbon stocks in tropical rainforest and also peat soils. And that was then used for the carbon emission trade schemes for companies to offset the CO2 pollution. Because that was not so very profitable and the share prices dropped significant, we started to work more for water catchment management. For example, Scottish Water has a lot of peatlands of 25 by 25 kilometer areas where the water is being filtered through the peat, and they use that in order for our drinking water. But what happens in peatlands, because of drainage of farmers and forestry, the peatland dries out, and when it rains then, the organic dissolved components from the peat go into the drinking water, it becomes brown, and the water companies have to filter it out. So with our satellite remote sensing, we can fly over once in a year, see where the most erosion is, send the people out there in order to either make it more moist or do not take water from that area. Then I came with agriculture in a project, and I thought, oh, that's very nice. Agriculture is much bigger than water catchment, so let's try remote sensing in agriculture. So my task was to sell satellite pictures to farmers, more or less, which I can do very well for once, but not for twice, because that's the end of the story. So what our capabilities are then is satellite remote sensing and data products, so that was more or less where I started. The current focus I have is on platform development, data integration, not only satellite data, but also other data, and then building knowledge and decision support. So our challenges in the world are very straightforward. Sustainable food production with less resource. We have climate change, environmental pressure of monocultures like palm oil. We have food security, price rises, which upset people very much who depend on it. We are looking at traceability for supply chains. We are looking at productivity increase because land use is very important, not only for agriculture, but also for housing, etc. So we want to be able to compete. Competitiveness in trade agreements with NAFTA and EU, etc. It's very important for certain developing countries to become more productive. And we're talking about investment and risk. So investment, for example, poor farmers don't have a lot of cash flow, cannot invest in their production, but the country wants to improve the production. The question is, which farmers shall we support and how do we assess their risk? So data in isolation, customer needs. Data is not a solution, and that is maybe very straightforward. I mean, satellite data comes in, it has some backscatter, there's a lot of noise, and that has to be processed. So even though these machines are very nice and very sexy and go with big rockets in the sky, it is not a solution. we have quantitative versus qualitative data. And a lot of people think, okay, with a satellite, we can track and trace, we have GPS, we can see a tank in a desert and boom, the tank is gone, and that's all very nice. But you also have to have some soft targets like agriculture, and there we are talking about qualitative circumstances of how a crop looks like. Even then, you can say, I'm 2 meters tall, and I can not tell you, but you know the Netherlands, but I could talk to some people in Colombia and say, well, I'm just a small guy in the Netherlands, we are on average 3 meters tall. So everything is relative. So if we even can translate a satellite picture to a state of a crop, then still we have to be able to relate that to time and to other circumstances. And we have to say, okay, the crop is half a meter, and that's good. Or the crop is half a meter and should be a meter. Then we talk about accurate, affordable, and timely data. We see the satellite flies over and has a resolution of 30 meters. Well, in this 30 meters, I cannot see an iceberg lattice, for example. It has to be affordable. I have to task the satellite for this iceberg lattice and it will become very expensive. Or timely, it flies around once in a week, and maybe once in a week is not good enough for the grower, or there is a cloud, so I have to do it once in 2 weeks. So there we have a problem with optical satellite. So data and context is multidisciplinary. We have the satellite, we have LiDAR, we have drones, we have people in the field. All this data has to be integrated with each other, because if one part falls out because it is not there, or another part is not affordable, we have to be able to combine that. There's also something like imperfect solutions. If we are putting everything together, we have to make an assumption that something is good enough. It's too vague. Well, I'm coming in the market with 80% accurate products. Yeah, with combining all this data, all these disciplines, 80% of a product, I cannot go to a grower because he will say, what about the other 20%? That is uncertainty. I'm not going to pay you for that. But if I go with 80% over 1,000 fields with a different product for insurance, for example, or for a processing industry, I'm having a better product and I can start there. And then later when I improve my product, I can go back to the grower one day when I have 95% accuracy. The multidisciplinary also, because I switched combination with this. Multidisciplinary is also that you have in situ, satellite, people in the field, statistics in order to combine your data, analyze the data, IT infrastructure, people in the field, people with knowledge of crop physiology. And I did not ask, who knows here about agriculture or is from agriculture? That's me. Have you? Yeah? A bit. So then I know what I have to look for. Okay. And that is data versus crop modeling. You can do data modeling. We see the satellite flying over here. I can see something. I have to make it qualitative. So I have to have here someone at the same moment measuring something on the crop so that I can model later when this guy walks around next time. Or you have the satellite flies over all the time. At the same time, I want someone on the ground to measure what the crop is doing, a certain biomass or canopy. And then I can train the data the next time that comes out of the satellite, and I can extrapolate it because I have some kind of modeled data. So if the satellite sees then something on another place, it can tell me, okay, it looks like this, so that means your canopy is 50%, for example. So that's modeling on the one hand. And there's also crop modeling that will then tell your crop has to be in a certain development at a certain stage because we have so many days with such a temperature and therefore the crop has developed so much. So there's two types of modeling. I see you all puzzled. But this is a little bit more what we are doing. We are putting data into context and we are measuring a couple of parameters that have to do with crop growth. So we have the soil, which is the production unit, as you want the oven, wherein we bake the cookie, wherein we grow the sugar beet. We have the operations, and that is you as a cook, starting to wake up, going into the field, sowing the plant, harvesting it, spraying it, etc. That is the management of the grower. We have the inputs, is your ingredients, is seeds, crop protection chemicals, fertilizer and water. And then we have environment, which can be abiotic or biotic. So there's two different things. Environment abiotic is our weather station measuring solar, measuring water, measuring wind, temperature, different places in the soil. And biotic is the weeds, pest and disease that the farmer has to control as much as possible. So all these parameters, and in sugar beet we have a 30 in total, influence the different processing stages of the sugar beet. We start with establishment, where the plant comes up and survives, and then we say, okay, it is fine. Then we have the development of root and canopy system. When that is finalized to a certain level and time, we are going into production, where the photosynthesis produces carbohydrates and sugar and starch. And then we come in the harvest storage period. So these parameters, good or bad, affect the length of this stage. If this is longer, it will push the other crop processing crop processes to the end and will reduce the yield potential. We can simulate that by algorithms. Putting the parameter data in the algorithms, we can come up with an S-curve of emergence, an S-curve of canopy development, a more other curve for the development of the yield per hectare. So this is from 0 to 70 tons in a couple of months. And then we have respiration when it is being stored. So this is how we can simulate more or less what is happening. But our simulations are not always very good, because we cannot put 30 parameters into this model. We cannot measure 30 parameters on an hourly basis. So what we have to do is calibrate with phenotyping, and phenotyping is using remote sensing and ground truthing in order to see how this crop is looking like, how it performs. We do that with a tablet, canopy and cover and biomass. We do it with sensors and satellite data. We take leaf area index, that is the amount of the number of times that the leaves cover the ground. And we do that with crop stress, near infrared, with satellite and radar, so that we have an idea how does this field, the crop develop, and how healthy is it. And in this case, because we are here talking about satellite, one of my tools here is satellite. And you can see that it is used in a combination of other in-situ measurements, but also UAV. We now even have UAVs that fly 20 kilometers high. So there's a lot of developments here going on. So how is this model calibrated? We have here the four different stages: establishment, development, production, and harvest and storage, whereby the blue curve is the modeled one and the red curve is the actual situation. We did some canopy measurements. I was running around with a tablet in a big field of 20 hectares. Well, not all the 20 hectares I ran around. I took a little plot of 25 by 25 meters, somewhere in the middle. It was still a lot of work, 40 fields in a day. And you can see that these are the measurements I took in the five times, and here I have a lot of variation of this canopy. This one is the satellite-derived canopy measurements, which are a little bit more smooth because it can do the whole field and you get a better average. And these ones are the modeled canopy developments, where it said, well, on the 21st of May it is about 25%, and then it goes to 100% on the 2nd of July. But what is most important is there was a big gap between actual and potential or modeled, and therefore we corrected this development stage, pushed forward the stage here. And if you want to do it even correctly, maybe it's even not getting to 100% anymore, so you have a lower development. But what it does mean is that the production is pushed to the end, and you get less production, because at the end of the year the photosynthesis activity goes down because solar radiation is less intense. So there's a finite moment in production of a crop, and therefore you want to push this line as much as possible to the front. So what we then do is a gap analysis in order to explain why the difference is. We do a gap analysis against the four measured parameter groups in order to understand what could be done better. And this looks like this, and we have seen from Richard also the different improvement processes. And we are doing this, by the way, we are collecting the data per field in near real time, because the production unit is unique, and if you want to improve it, you have to be able to give accurate advice. Otherwise, nobody's paying it for it, apart from insurance companies, maybe. So here are the growth parameters, and here's the mathematical modeling. So we produce the simulations, which we correct with this phenotyping, and we come to a calibrated crop status. Out of this calibrated crop status, we have here the products which are accessible for the customers, like crop performance monitoring. We do a gap analysis against the growth parameters, and then we can see what is the parameter impact, and we can do a yield forecast. And we can also say, okay, there's climate change because temperatures over time are changing. And out of this information, we have built 7 decision support modules. This is productivity in change, in-season optimization of crop production. Investment is over across seasons, so you can advise on investment in capital goods. With crop monitoring, so the government can see if enough food is being produced for food security. The value chain is an integration of production for the processing industry, of insurance, environment, least possible impact of your inputs on the environment, and we have R&D, because we would like to support research development companies like seeds and crop protection chemicals in order to explain how their inputs react to environmental circumstances. And we come here to decision support in the form of alerts and reports. And if you do that, then and change the inputs or change certain management practices like precision farming, then you can change also the calibrated crop status, and within the season you can see an optimization or over seasons. But this is for us to start somewhere, because we are not mathematical modelers, we are not farmers that collect all data, we are not satellite specialists, but we need some kind of platform to improve the modeling, but also improve the quality and quantity and the ways of where we collect the data. And we have to be able to see if we have to do things with satellite or with people in the ground. But we also have to see how can we sell this product, which in the beginning will be imperfect. So how do I position this product in the market, at which product? And from there on, I can then maybe develop more offerings and leverage the cost of the data over these offerings in the future. So that is our objective. How this will look like to the grower or the user, because it's not only the grower that we are going to advise, it will be government, it will be traders, it will be input suppliers, equipment suppliers, and even the consumer. This is a field. We take here some infrared pictures. These are the simulations. And the grower or user can interrogate the data of that field. These are the 7 decision support modules that I presented earlier, supply chain to R&D. And you can see here that is the scope from multiple to single fields, with here the different objectives and here the different customers. So you can understand that it becomes a pretty complicated matter in order to figure out where am I going to position myself? What product am I going to launch in the market? Can I finance this development time? And how long is it? Is it going to be 2 months, 2 years, or 20 years? Yeah. So you have to be realistic in order to say to your investor, okay, this will take so and so long. And therefore, we are also very happy that we are supported by Innovate UK. We have a project at the moment with Reading University on the improvement of grassland production by using satellite Sentinel-1 radar data in order to establish what the biomass is. This project starts in September and will last for 2 years. We are doing at the moment field trials with growers and breeders. At the same time as that the satellite flies over, we take observation on sugar beet fields of KWS and Ses van der Haaf and a Bury beet group. And that is how we do our research. We have pilots with processor in Ukraine with EDNF Man. We have a lot of collaborations with research institutes like Cranfield, Reading, University of Nottingham, but also Plant Research International in Wageningen in the Netherlands. And we are building at the moment our modeling and platform capabilities. Fortunately, the investors realize that we need to build a team with skills and competency that is not only a spotty kid behind a computer, but also software engineers for the infrastructure and crop modelers with crop physiology knowledge in combination with some marketing knowledge on where to position this product. Thank you.
Your business focus primarily in the UK or Europe, or are you doing this kind of observation and monitoring internationally?
Well, in principle, in the future, I would say my vision would be that I could supply this service to a half an acre farmer in Kenya. I mean, that would be nice. But on the way to there, I will have worldwide better opportunities in order to develop that platform, in order to do the modeling and then spread out on the different crops. But yes, it will be worldwide application.
When are we launching?
We are hiring a crop modeler at the moment because we do it now together with University of Nottingham. Then we are collecting the data. We are talking about building a platform that is dynamic, so not only for the water that you do it on a consulting basis, but that you have an ongoing platform that is hourly updated. So I would say next year. But I think in order to build a product and improve a product, you have to have something that works. Even if we only analyze the weather for a field, then I would be already happy. Yeah? So, and then if I can start analyzing the individual data of, because that is what is going on in agriculture. Everybody's developing a platform. The input providers, the Syngentas, the seed companies develop a platform in order to have an additional service to the growers, to help them with fertilizer, help them with the weather. The equipment manufacturers do the same. And what our aim is to become a platform in the middle that is brandless, independent, and can analyze the data for all these individual companies, but also make it stronger by a combined offering, integrating the seeds with the weather, with the soil, and with the management of the grower. So, but that will be a long journey.
Thank you very much.
Okay.